Hey folks, welcome to a little bit of virtual reality. We're just going to be doing a lecture online, and this is just one way that you'll be able to refer back to this lecture frequently and listen to my voice smoothly taking you through it. So this is Chapter 24, Physical Therapy, Rehabilitation, and Alternative Medical Nursing. As I said, we'll go through the objectives fairly quickly. You can go back and check these. Make sure you have these objectives taken care of in this version or another version. Anytime you think I'm going too quickly, talking too quickly, you can actually slow the video down and take it bit by bit. So what we're talking about is complementary and alternative therapy. Complementary meaning it's working with regular Western medicine, what we know as Western medicine. This is a more natural approach. It's considered holistic, looking at the whole animal in an ongoing dynamic process, dealing with different variabilities in the state of health. We're also talking about rehabilitation as far as acupuncture, chiropractic treatments. We're going to talk about some other treatments, cold laser treatments, physical therapy, that kind of thing as well. We'll also cover nutraceuticals and chondroprotectants. Nutraceuticals are not herbs necessarily. They're not solely herbs. They're not approved as drugs. They are nutritional aspects or food kind of aspects coming from animals or plants that seem to provide general health, maintain general health and well-being. They're used to treat many conditions. They are becoming more mainstream. You may have heard of glucosamine chondroitin sulfate. That's very commonly used for arthritis. Omatic omega-3 fatty acids are huge. They are great for brain health, for joint health, for general nerve health, and for skin. Polysulfated glycosaminoglycans, you don't have to be smart to say that. You just have to practice saying that. But those are PS gags, or they are the building blocks of cartilage, and so they help with joint health. And hyaluronic acid, it's actually a lot of products that are for joint health should contain something that help to build cartilage, and hyaluronic acid is one of the building blocks for cartilage as well. Herbal medicine is different from nutraceuticals. It is comprised just of herbs. It's all made from plant materials. It's the most ancient known medicine. If you think about it, it's what people could find available that made them feel better. The most common one, or the first one we know about, is willow bark, used as aspirin or for pain relief in historical ancient history. It's the foundation of modern medicine. It's typically less toxic than drugs, but you do have to be careful because there are some things that can be toxic. It's not proven safe in pregnancy. A lot of these herbal medicines are toxic to cats. So you do have to be careful about it. You have to be cautious about where you get it from. These things are not regulated, and so anybody can put anything out there and put any label that they want on it. Chinese herbal medicine, or traditional Chinese medicine, herbal medicine is they use the herbs, but they diagnose first. And this has been around for thousands of years, a lot of science behind this. They use the herbs to diagnose conditions, but also to treat conditions. And there are very specific formulas that are named for function or within the main ingredients. And there are also formulas that combine several products. A practitioner needs to have formal training in order to practice Chinese herbal medicine and to make sure that those herbs come from a reputable source, something that is organic, doesn't have any pesticides or anything that is included with it. Use of animal products is typically not done and can be a serious concern with Chinese herbal medicine. Western herbs. When we talk about Western herbs, we often think of that snake oil salesman who is just putting things together in a bottle, and we call that proprietary blends. We don't know what's in the bottle. We don't know what the bottle contains and if it actually has any effect. So we do have to be careful with that. There's no regulation behind it, but they come in different forms like bulk herbs, capsules, tablets, teas, extracts, poultices and compresses, things you put on topically, ointments, essential oils. Again, absolutely no oversight in this. So you have to look for good sources. Tend to support general health, go that tonification, toning up. If it's taken over a long period of time, so it does take a lot of time for these things to work. Can aid in detoxification. When we administer herbs, whether it's Western herbs, Chinese herbs, typically want to administer on an empty stomach with a very small amount of water or a salt-free broth or juice if we have small animals. Ayurvedic herbs. This comes from India. This is Ayurvedic means the science of life. This includes herbal prescriptions, diet, massage, exercise, and meditation. All of these things together creating a more healthy lifestyle or well-being. There's some formulations of multiple ingredients. Acupuncture is the technique of piercing skin with needle at specific predetermined points. It's a medical method used within traditional Chinese medicine, most commonly used as pain management. Within veterinary medicine, you have to be certified as an acupuncturist, and you need to be a licensed veterinarian to work with acupuncture with pets. But you may see it in a practice. You may see it used within a practice. The terminology, we talk about meridians or channels. These are pathways that connect acupuncture points. And these are actually like electrical, they think they're electrical pathways. And this has been studied again for thousands and thousands of years so that they have these charted for canines, equine, horses, cats. But every species have certain meridians or channels associated along the body. 14 classical ones, 12 are associated with specific organ systems, and 2 run along the midlines in the body. And you can see that all these points are charted. And part of learning acupuncture is actually knowing these anatomical points where you can affect different organ systems and the working of the body. So there are a lot of theories about why acupuncture works, and probably it's a combination of a number of these different theories. We know for a fact that energy is circulating through your body, and it circulates through the meridians every 24 hours. Any blockage of energy manifests as dysfunction or disease, and stagnant energy that is staying in one place, causes painful spasms or swelling. Deficient energy is going to cause atrophy or weakness. And if we stimulate or sedate energy levels at those acupuncture points, that's how we bring the body into balance. So there's the 5 different theories. The gate theory, meaning we're opening or closing these gates at these different points to move energy along or close energy up. There's the endogenous opioid theory, which postulates that if we're poking in an area, we're releasing endorphins in that area. Endorphins are very similar to opioids in that our receptors take in those, it's endogenous, so it's inner opioid. Our receptors respond to that, make us feel good, release pain in that area. So there's thought that just poking those areas releases opioids in those areas. Another thought is that it stimulates the autonomic. If you see autonomic, it sort of means the same thing as automatic nervous system. So anything that is not voluntary, anything that is involuntary, it's stimulating that. There's the humoral theory, which is really interesting because what they've found is that when they take the blood from an animal that has been treated with acupuncture and injected the blood into an animal that has not been treated with acupuncture, they have the same effect. The effect that you see in one animal, you will also see in the other animal. So they think that some of what is going on is going into the blood and is creating an effect throughout the body. Another thing that is a theory that's out there is bioelectric, so just changing the way that the electricity moves through the body. That may be one of the ways that acupuncture works. So I do believe that there are a number of theories, and there have been a lot of studies on these theories, and I think that the number of those theories there are certain things of those that are true and certain things that may not be true, but there's, I think, a number of things going on with acupuncture that causes it to work, and we know that it does work. Some things you'll hear about with acupuncture techniques, dry needling is a different acupuncture technique. We use stainless steel acupuncture needles for that. Moxibustion is when you dry leaves of certain herbs, Artemisia vulgaris or the mugwort plant, at those acupuncture points causes a change. It tends to increase the acupuncture, the effect of the acupuncture. Aquapuncture can be used. You can use water or saline, usually saline, or some sort of solution right at the acupuncture point, and that will keep pressure in that acupuncture point for a little bit longer. Electroacupuncture is the passing of electrical energy through the acupuncture points. You can do that with stainless steel needles. Implantation is when you actually surgically implant sterile material in the acupuncture point so that you can have continuous stimulation that will last longer. So use catgut, stainless steel, silver, and most often gold. Gold is something that is used fairly frequently with acupuncture. And it's considered a surgical procedure. Obviously has to be done aseptically. So here's, this is actually acupuncture of a site using saline in a site. And we can also use cold lasers, and we'll talk about cold lasers later, but using low intensity lasers or cold laser stimulate the acu, it causes vibration of the cells at that specific spot. So that's one way to use it. Acupressure, just putting pressure on that point. If you've ever had a headache and somebody said, hold between your in the web of your hand between your thumb and your forefinger, that's considered acupressure. Needle placement and removal is the most common thing that we use, and usually use acupuncture needles for that, but we can use regular needles as well. Clinical indications for acupuncture: any pain or lameness, musculoskeletal disorders, neurologic disorders. What's interesting is that with intervertebral disc disease, that's IVDD, if somebody has slipped a disc, basically what that means is that there are cushions between each of your vertebrae, and if one of those cushions moves out of place, it can interfere with a spinal cord. And usually that's a surgical condition, if not a euthanasia condition. And what they found is that with acupuncture, if the animal continues to have deep pain, which indicates that there's still nerve function all the way to the leg, to the back legs, if they continue to have at least deep pain, that means that there's still nerve, a working nerve there, then acupuncture is 90% effective in taking care of that pain versus 76% with surgery. Surgery is 76% effective. Acupuncture is 90% effective. So it's actually better to do acupuncture than surgery in some of those cases. We can use acupuncture for dermatologic disorders, that's skin disorders, behavioral disorders, reproductive disorders, GI disorders, and just to improve quality of life. Veterinary spinal manipulative therapy, or VSMT, is chiropractic therapy. It just is a manual movement. It manually restores reduced motion in spine and limbs by manually moving the spine and the limbs. It does need to be performed by a trained professional. You just can't go around and crack your dog's back. A veterinarian that's been specifically trained, or a chiropractor that's been specifically trained on animals. They need to be trained on animals. Subluxation or vertebral subluxation complex is when you have an abnormal relationship between the two adjacent vertebrae. If you're like me, you occasionally wake up with a crick in your neck, that's a subluxation. Your neck's not out of joint, but your couple of your vertebrae may be out of joints, just slightly out of joint. So there are signs of subluxation that you can see in animals, the difficulty walking. If it's a horse, a horse may not want to be saddled or ridden. Causes can be just normal, everyday working animal pulls a muscle, which will pull a joint out of whack. So we can see these things. Chiropractor can fix these things, and it's becoming more mainstream. For a technician, if you are working with a doctor that does do manipulation, a lot of times you're just restraining the patient. You can do it with dogs, cats, horses, cattle. Sometimes you're preparing the chemical restraint, giving the chemical restraint to sedate the patient a little bit. You may be stabilizing nearby segments. So if it's a large animal, It takes a huge amount of pressure. The doctor actually has to be up on a ladder sometimes. And you may be stabilizing another segment of the vertebrae in order for them to move the other segment. You'll also be recording all of this, doing medical records. Immediately after treatment, your role may be to massage the patient, apply essential oils, walk the patient around, and to communicate with the client what's been going on. With physical therapy and rehabilitation, it's the relief of pain and restoration of mobility and function. That's our goal. It is generally a team effort, but your role is extensive. There are training and certification programs available, and you just need to determine what's the appropriate one for you. There are two available, actually, in the United States. One is in Florida, and one is through the University of Tennessee. Both of those have online programs that you then go for a couple of weeks to get certified. It starts, of course, with a patient evaluation with a history, a general physical, and then a very specific orthopedic and neurologic examination. The therapist will then devise that therapy plan. It's usually an exercise-based therapy, much as physical therapy is with us. The exercise is the key of rehabilitation program, and the level of intensity and duration is based on the patient's strength and pain level. And we just need to start out conservatively to avoid those setbacks, because when you hurt them, they stop. So we'll do strengthening exercises targeting specific muscle groups. For instance, if we have a cruciate surgery and the doctor wants to do physical therapy, I highly recommend physical therapy afterwards. We're going to start by just moving that knee around, strengthening the joints, strengthening the muscles, eventually get to walking, do some proprioceptive exercises, so making sure they know where their body, their limbs are, so making them stepping over poles, that kind of thing, and then balance exercises to improve overall stability. Then we'll move on to endurance exercises to emphasize work on the cardiovascular system. Neuromuscular re-education exercises, including posture improvement and gait corrections. We'll have the owner follow an exercise plan, and that will be developed by the veterinarian or physical therapist. And then that certified rehabilitation technician is going to be the one that performs that exercise and teaches the client how to do that at home. This is pretty popular. It's starting to gain more popularity. We have a couple of these treadmills in the area. They use warm water and teach the animal to accept this comfortably. A technician is going to help train the animal to do this and then encourage the animal to use the treadmill. You can also use a land treadmill for increasing strength and endurance and for re-educating front-to-back balance and normal foot placement. It's best if we can use it, one that goes uphill and downhill, so that we can maximize the effect. The technician is going to be training that patient to use the treadmill, monitoring the patient while they're on that treadmill, and then recording that their time, speed, angle, and progress. Massage. Everybody loves massage. Your animals love massage. And the definition is the systematic and scientific manipulation of the soft tissues, and you do have to have some knowledge of the anatomy, the musculature anatomy and ligament anatomy, in order to understand. Now, you're going to learn anatomy in the fall, but there are certification classes out there to do animal massage as well. Shiatsu massage is the finger pressure on specific points in the body, and what that does is it increases circulation and stimulates the nervous system, and you do have to be aware of what those points need to be. Trigger point massage or myotherapy is when you find taut bands or knots and use ischemic compression to relieve. Now, let me explain this, and I usually can do this within the classroom. I have a volunteer come up, and I find a knot on your back with your permission. And it doesn't take long because most of you have pretty tight muscles. You're pretty stressed. You have a knot. So I find a knot on your neck. I will push in, and I will stop the blood flow. That's ischemic compression. That ischemia means to stop the blood flow. So I press in just enough to stop the blood flow. Not enough to really hurt, but just enough that you feel it and you go, oh, that hurts so good. Okay. So we stop the blood flow, and then I will have you breathe in and breathe out and let go. And as I let go, and I do it fairly quickly, all the blood flows back into the area. It gets nice and warm, and it actually relaxes the muscle. I send you back to your seat. You feel so much better for the rest of the lecture. I can't do that right now, but you'll have to do it with yourself or with a friend and see how that works. Sports massage, you often see athletes after an event getting massaged. It's good for the muscles. T-team, Tellington Touch, teaches a physical awareness of the body, and it only manipulates the skin of the body. It does not manipulate actually the muscles of the body. Swedish massage is the most common type. It's if you go to a massage parlor, if you're a masseuse, somebody you trust, and you have a massage, it's just the kneading and the moving of the muscles along the normal planes. Not painful, should not be painful at all. It's the most commonly type one used. So effleurage is the one I'm talking about, kind of a trigger point massage that then releases very quickly, allows that blood flow to come back. Use a gliding stroke that follows the contour of the body. It usually feels pretty good. Petrissage is what we call kneading of the muscles. Use a rhythmic lifting, squeeze, and release. Friction can increase the blood flow to the area and the warmth of the area, manipulating the tissue. This all increases circulation, which is what we're looking for. Tapotment is a tapping motion that is also a massage technique. Coupage is a form of tapotment. We talked about that briefly, but it's where you cup your hands on either side of the chest or on one side of the chest, and you bang against the chest, not too hard, but hard enough that what you're doing is loosening phlegm, and that's a form of tapotment or massage technique. It's physical therapy. Vibration. This is a fairly new, probably been in use for 10 to 15 years. It's a vibration of the entire body that causes the muscles to kind of loosen or shake against each other and kind of increases blood flow to the body. There are some people who swear by it, some people who say, no, it bothers me, I don't like it, I don't like to see it. We use it for horses, for working horses, use it for animals, we use it for people as well. Swedish massage breaks massage into elements. It starts with intention. I don't know if you've ever had a massage. Your massage therapist will come in and will just take a nice cleansing breath. Their intention has a lot to do with how you feel about the whole process. So they take a nice breath and they center themselves and they come in with the intention of making you feel better. And you feel better. Then it has touch. They ask you, is this enough pressure? Do you want me to go deeper? And you do what feels good to your muscles. If you have them go deeply, they're going to release a lot more toxins into your bloodstream. It's actually going to make you feel worse, so you do have to kind of balance that a little bit. Excursion, speed, rhythm, continuity, duration, and sequence. Every masseuse is going to have their own different rhythm of how they do this and how it works, and really you have to work with the animal to see what works with them. Now, the only reasons we wouldn't want to do massage is if they have any bacterially or virally, fungally infected lesions. We don't want to rub that throughout the body. Any open wounds, obviously that would hurt. Any area of acute injury or inflammatory condition, that's going to cause things to be worse. An area of hemorrhage or if they're bleeding or a recent high fever, those are the things we wouldn't want to do massage with. Otherwise, I highly recommend that you start to massage your pets. Passive range of motion is something we do generally directly after we do some sort of surgery, and it's just stretching. It's preserving that normal range of motion or returning the normal range of motion if it's absent. It increases cartilage nutrition to the joint because moving cartilage feeds the joint, and it stimulates cartilage regeneration in a good way. Basically, you don't want to, the rules are that you do not want to extend the joint or flex the joint past where it is comfortable. So you only want to do one joint at a time. So you want to isolate the joint and then just slowly move that joint so that it is comfortable for the pet. Eventually, you're going to stretch it a little further, move a little bit more. But if they're starting to lick their lips or chew or bite you, that's too much. Okay, moving on. Electrical and magnetic-based therapy. If you've seen TENS units or electrical stimulation units, this is what that is. Basically, it is little electrodes that are taped or stuck to the skin. Sometimes you have to shave a spot to get it there. And what you do is you increase the frequency or pulse duration or the intensity. You ramp it up over time and maybe increase the time. It stimulates the cells around the inflamed or diseased spot, stimulates the muscle tissue. You don't really want the muscles to twitch too much, but a little bit of twitching is okay. It just increases the movement of fluid through that area, which can increase healing. So neuromuscular electrical stimulation, it's like a TENS unit again. It can strengthen muscles if you have the muscle to the point that it's twitching. The electric current elicits the contraction of the muscle. We do definitely have some clinical uses for that. If you have an atrophied muscle because they're not using it because they're painful, we really need that muscle to be intact, especially if we're going to do some type of surgery to make them use that joint again. We want that muscle to be intact. And you need to be trained on where those pads need to be placed in order for you to get the best result. Your role, if you're using this, is to shave and clean the skin, apply the gel and the pads. The gel helps the conduction of the electricity into the body. You need to know how to use the machine, how to monitor the patient through the session and record that session. You need to know anatomy in order to do this correctly. Bioelectrical stimulation, just real briefly, it's a transcutaneal electrical nerve stimulation. It's used for pain relief typically. You do one frequency in one direction and another in a perpendicular direction to treat deep aching and chronic pain. You attach leads on either side of the area to be treated, and once before they're attached, those leads are attached, you do need to shave and clean the skin, and then you set the frequency and the amplitude and administer the treatment and then record it. Magnets are a big thing too. So therapeutic magnets range from 100 to 3,000. I don't know what the G is actually. I need to look that up, but it's a unit of measure for the strength of the magnet. If the magnet is below 500, it's deemed ineffective. So we need between 1,000 to 3,000. They do have north and south poles on the magnet, remember, and they do have different effects. Pulsating electromagnetic waves are accelerated electrical charges with different frequencies for varying effects. There's also pulsed signal therapy that can be used as well, and an CC device. So this is magnetic stimulation. It's not used in every clinic. You probably will, very few of you will actually see this being used, but we do talk about it because it is one of the pain relief things that we can use. A laser. This is a cold laser. This is a unit. I actually have one of these units. It's light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. That's what laser stands for. This is low-level laser therapy, so it's at a certain wavelength. It doesn't go above a certain wavelength. We call it cold laser because, as opposed to the laser surgeries that you might see, it does not heat up or cut the skin. We're going to use it for things like inflammation or joint healing or pain or lick granulomas. We use it for behavior and certain skin conditions as well. But we do have to be careful with cold lasers. They're not for everything. If there's any metal in the body or at the spot where you are doing laser, it can actually irritate that area. It's not for use with cancers. What it does is it stimulates cells and it can stimulate cell growth. So if you use it over an area that has cancer or infection, it can actually make cancers or infection much worse. There are different classes of lasers. Class 1 and class 2 typically aren't used. Class 3A and 3B are the most commonly used. They're the safest ones. Class 4 is very dangerous use. It is actually one that is used in clinics fairly frequently. It's very expensive. It all from class 3 or class 2 on, these all require you to wear special glasses. If you don't wear special glasses, it will burn your retina. So even though you can't see the laser, you can't see the light coming out of the laser, it will burn your retina and you could go blind. So we really want you to pay attention to that and wear special glasses if you're in a clinic that uses a laser. Class 3A is 1 to 5 megawatts. Class 3B is 5 to 500 megawatts. Anything greater than 500 megawatts or more is class 4. When you use a class 4 laser, it is a special device that actually does it for you. When you're using a class 3 laser, you're actually counting the time that you have the laser applied. The class 4 laser will do it for you because it's much more dangerous to use. Therapeutic ultrasound works in a lot, very much the same way as the laser. Laser is using light. Ultrasound is using sound. It is causing waves to go through the cells and causing them to vibrate at a certain vibration that is a healthy vibration for the cells and increases communication between the cells. So you may have to shave the area or clean with alcohol before you administer the ultrasound. You would be taught how to do this. But you can see that this animal has had probably a cruciate surgery, some type of knee surgery recently, and we're using ultrasonic therapy in order to help heal that wound and decrease the inflammation. Extracorporeal shockwave. They used to have these in the malls. I don't actually know if they still have this, but it's a high energy focused pressure sound wave. It could also be actually a water wave as well that delivers energy to a specific focal point in the body. It produces a loud sound and an uncomfortable sensation. We have to sedate the patient to do that. Treatment is very short. And actually sedate the patient and put something in their ears so that we don't have a problem with their ears. But I don't see this used very often, but I want to put that out there because it is another form of pain relief. Cryotherapy. Everybody's done this. You hurt yourself. You kick your toe. You stub your toe. Somebody says, do you want a bag of ice? Yes. Cryotherapy works. Cold therapy removes heat when applied to the body. So we have to be careful with animals that don't conserve heat very well, but it does cause vasoconstriction, but when we have an acute injury, it is the best thing that you can do in order to decrease inflammation and decrease future swelling for that injury. Some different things you can use. A Dixie cup is 3/4 full that you freeze. Commercial cool packs, those come in your weekly orders with your vaccines. Frozen peas. I love putting a bag of frozen peas and using it. Put the frozen pea bag in another Ziploc bag to keep it around a little bit longer. Frozen peas, because they don't freeze solid, it makes a much more comfortable thing to put on an animal. It kind of bends with the animal. Alcohol and water in a Ziploc freezer bag will not freeze completely and will be a little bit more moldable to the animal. There are machines that do cold water through a cycle through something you can wrap around a limb, or doing cold hose over an injury for large animal patients, using therapeutic ice boots in equine extremities. Cryotherapy works. I highly recommend it for humans. I highly recommend it for animals. Putting a cold pack of peas on an animal after a spay or a neuter will reduce the healing time significantly. They will feel much better. Thermotherapy, sometimes we use wet heat. If we have a hand towel, what we do is get a bowl of hot water, use a hand towel or a bath towel, wring it out, and apply the heat for 10 to 15 minutes. If the towel gets cool, put it back in the hot water, wring it out, put it over the area for 10 to 15 minutes. One thing we have to remember anytime we're using cold or hot therapy is if the animal doesn't have any sensory sensation in that area, it's not a good idea to do that because they can't move away from you when you're actually damaging the skin. So you want to be real careful with that. one of the places where I might use thermotherapy is if we have an abscess or an anal gland abscess or some swelling that we want to get blood flow through. And sometimes you use thermotherapy and then use cryotherapy and then use thermotherapy and then use cryotherapy. Using the combination is very helpful. All right, moving on to harnesses and slings. We use these if we have, if we think we're going to get back to full independence shortly. We'll use slings. We'll use a wheelchair if the animal has to have independence and isn't able to maintain their weight for the long period of time. It can really help your client to assist the dog move around in a normal way. Animals moving around in a normal way will get them back to a normal existence a lot faster. Large animals, we can have a pulley system attached to a ceiling beam and get them hoisted up off of their limbs as well. Nail caps can be used to protect nails from wear, so that's a protective device. Another protective device we might use is a boot to protect the entire paw. We can use elastic bands to attach them if we need be, but we have to be careful they're not too tight. Assistive devices are braces or wraps that provide light to moderate support for recovery, and they can help with limb alignment. So if you have a sprain or a mildly fractured limb, we might be able to use some type of splint in order to help with that. Custom orthotics provides more rigid support. If the joint is not commonly braced, it provides more. It's more of a splint. It's firmer. They can walk in it, but their limb is still there. That's an orthotic is different from a prosthetic. A prosthetic replaces that limb that is missing. So here's a prosthetic replacing the limbs. This is an orthotic. The whole limb would go into that and help the animal to walk better. This little guy with a wheelchair, custom made, allows that patient freedom of movement, regular exercise. You do need to supervise them, make sure they don't get any sores or wounds, and that they're properly fitted. And you want to introduce it for very short periods of time. So that's it for Chapter 24. Good job on your first learning through online learning. And if you have any questions, let's chat about it.